Welcome to Webcast Worship, recorded by your friends at Grace Presbyterian Church. I'm Pastor Neil. If you had to describe Jesus in just a few words, what would they be? The first words that came to my mind were bold, courageous, compassionate, and strong. Jesus was all of those things, especially when he confronted the powers that be. But there was another side to Jesus, a very tender side that drew so many people to him, especially those who were suffering and in need. That's one reason I decided to preach upon the fruits of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, and so on. And the way those fruits were revealed in Christ. Today we come to gentleness. Not the first word that comes to my mind when thinking of Jesus. Nonetheless, it was a trait he did possess, especially when he dealt with others who were vulnerable and weak. This morning, we will peruse one story that reveals Christ's gentleness. We'll also talk about the meaning of that trait for us. But first, I invite you to focus upon the power that is revealed in all three members of the Trinity and the way their power is used for us.
This is the Christ, the Holy Son of God, our Savior, Lord, Redeemer of mankind. This is the Christ, the healer of our souls, who ransomed us with love divine.
Good morning. Please join me in the call to worship. We will be reading from Psalm 145. I will exalt you, my God the King. I will praise your name forever and ever.
Every day I will praise you and extol your name forever and ever.
One generation commends your works to another. They tell of your mighty acts.
They speak of the glorious splendor of your majesty, and I will meditate on your wonderful works.
Shield and defender.
morning, boys and girls. It's me, Ashley Childress, and I hope you're doing well. Today, we are going to be learning about God's love and his graciousness and his gentleness for us and how we are all unique and special children of God. Do you guys remember the story when the children wanted to come to see Jesus, to sit with him, and there was a big crowd, and some of the disciples even said, no, shoot, you guys get out of here, you're bothering him. And Jesus said, no, let the children come. They are showing you how we are supposed to be as children of God. We get to come to Christ as children of God, all of us do. So today, I actually thought it would be neat to remind you of how special that you are to Jesus. Have you ever played with kinetic sand? This isn't the same kind of sand that you find at the seashore that sometimes gets stuck in your fingers and your toes. This is the kind that you can find it at a craft store, but it pulls apart, but you can still see the fun grains in there. It's really fun to play with. And this was a special gift from our friend Kenna at church and Miss Patricia for Cosette's birthday. And Cosette loves to play in her sensory table. Let's see. We make all kinds of things. That didn't come out very well, did it? But I wanted to show you some of her. Let's see if we can get a good shot of some of her special things. I'm sorry if it's a little blurry. Can you see the pearl down there? Some of her friends that she keeps in there. And so I just wanted to make sure that all of you knew how special that you are and how unique that you all are. Because God tells us that the love that God has for us and the thoughts that God thinks about each and every one of you is as numerous as the grains of sand. Isn't that amazing? So when we think about our friends, Kellen and Brixton and Emma and London and Eric and Carlisle and Victoria and Carter and Cosette, Aiden and Kenna, Kate, Bryce, Blake, Isabel, Hunter, and anyone else I can't think of, I apologize. We can remember how much we are loved by our God and how special and unique we are. Have a wonderful day. We'll see you back here next time.
Thank you, Ashley, for reminding us of how special each child is in God's eyes. Sometimes we forget that as we age. Thus, it's appropriate to go to God in prayer, confessing our failures, seeking his guidance, and trusting his grace. Please join me now in prayer.
Gracious and holy God, your sacred word declares that there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. But we often fail to trust that holy word. You do not condemn us, but we condemn ourselves. You do not reject us, but we reject so many others for whom our Savior died. Lord, in your mercy, cast out this bitter spirit from our hearts and minds, so that our lives might be a witness to the hope that you provide all those who trust in Christ. For it is in his name we pray. Amen.
Sisters and brothers in Christ, the mercies of God are from everlasting to everlasting. Let us proclaim the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God.
Each day.
Thank you, music team. Last week, I mentioned three volunteers who really stepped up about 1 year ago when our church began to adjust to the pandemic. I'll mention several other volunteers in the weeks to come, but today, I'd like to give a shout out to our staff. Marcy LeBlanc, our nursery worker, had only been with us about a year when everything got shut down, but she continued to serve us faithfully whenever we met outdoors. Ashley Chastant had been with us even less than that when she began work as our children's ministry director, but her reliability, creativity, and great organizational skills have really been a blessing to our church. Kathy Nelson, our office manager, has been with us much longer than I have, and I don't know what I'd do without her. She packed up computers and files with just a few days' notice and moved our whole church office into her home for the last 12 months. Continuing to work from there, she's been a whiz. Donna Kilpatrick, our church accompanist, has been as reliable as a good Swiss watch. She keeps our choir in sync, and she keeps the whole church in sync when we sing congregational hymns. She truly does not miss a beat. But the person I really want to encourage on this Sunday morning is our music director, Brad Allen, whose many gifts and skills have really blessed us on this webcast. Brad happened to have the equipment that we would need to make this service happen 12 months ago, and he used it to blend all sorts of individual voices sent from cell phones into a well-harmonized chorus. He also used the exceptional voice of his own wife to make pre-recorded tracks for the chorus to join. Their work has been exceptional from the start. So we owe a big debt of gratitude to them. Looking forward to next year, I'm happy to report that we're beginning to worship indoors once again on Sunday mornings. If you'd like to be a part of that, you will need to wear a face mask and practice social distancing. You also may need to come early, especially for Palm Sunday, because we are currently limited to 100 worshipers in the sanctuary. But we will have overflow seating on the patio for simulcast worship on that particular day. This year, we will use Palm Sunday to tell the story of Christ's passion, beginning with his ride into Jerusalem and concluding with his death upon the cross. We'll do that with gorgeous music and some very poignant readings. So you may well wish to share that service with your friends. You may also wish to join us on Maundy Thursday for a webcast presentation by David Brickner, a very engaging speaker who does a beautiful job of connecting the story of the Passover with the life and death of Christ. That service will be webcast only. But when Easter rolls around, we'll actually have three services. Webcast whenever you want it, indoors at 9:30, and outdoors at 11. We will also have an Easter egg hunt for children between the two live services. That day is going to be so much fun, but our seating capacity is limited, so be sure to come a bit early, especially if you want to sit indoors. Moving on to prayer concerns, I'm happy to report that Dorothy Gerard is recuperating from hip surgery and Joe Barrett is recuperating from a fall. But they both have a long way to go, so I know they would appreciate your prayers. I hope you'll pray for the young people who are bursting with energy and starving to celebrate with their friends. Pray that God gives them wisdom and at least a modicum of restraint to protect the ones they love from COVID-19 until all of us can gather safely once again. Until then, be sure to pray for those still battling COVID-19, particularly for the people of Europe in the midst of another COVID spike. And be sure to get your shot just as soon as it becomes available. I can tell you from experience that a sore arm and a head cold are much better than the alternative in this case. With those thoughts in mind, let us go to God in prayer. Dear Lord, we are so grateful for the staff and volunteers who work so very hard to make this webcast. We're also grateful for the staff and volunteers who have found safe ways for us to gather as a community again. Help us as a church to model that for others, and help us, God, to do it well. We intercede for the people of Europe who are facing another sweeping shutdown at the very cusp of Holy Week. And we pray that the young folks in our country might help us to prevent that sort of problem here. We also pray that more and more people will choose to receive these new vaccines just as soon as they are able, so they might help to keep us safe as well. Then, as we plan for a great day of reunion at some point in the future, we pray that the story of our Savior's life and death might give us hope for reunion, not only in this world, but in the world to come. For we do ask it in your holy name. Amen. Now I invite you to join me in the prayer our Savior taught us, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Remember me in a Bible cracked and faded by these. Remember me in a sanctuary filled with silent prayer. And age to age and heart to tears of joy fall from your eyes. And age to age and heart to heart, bound by grace and peace, child of wonder, child of God, I remember. Remember me when the children leave their Sunday school with smiles. Remember me when they're old enough to teach, old enough to preach, old enough to lead. And age to age and heart to heart, bound by grace and peace.
Thank you, Brad and Janine, for that very sweet reminder of the faith that does bind us hand to hand and heart to heart across many generations. According to this morning's Bible story, Jesus Christ was clear about that mission. He wanted his ministry to bless everyone, from the youngest to the oldest, in their midst. But his followers were less clear about that point, so he used some strident words to make the gentleness of God much more clear to them. The story comes to us from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 10, beginning with verse 13. So I encourage you to listen now for the word of God to you.
People were bringing little children to Jesus for him to place his hands on them, but the disciples rebuked them. When Jesus saw this, he was incensed. He said to them, "Let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. Truly I tell you, whoever does not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it." Then he wrapped the children in his arms, placed his hands on them, and blessed them. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
There was something about Jesus's hands. People longed to touch them and to be touched by them. When Jesus touched the lepers, when he touched the blind man, when he touched the deaf, good things occurred. Sores healed, eyes opened, minds cleared. We don't know exactly how all that happened, but we know a lot of folks wanted that to happen. They wanted Christ to touch them, to bless them, to heal them in some way. They wanted it for themselves, and they wanted it for their families, too. In this morning's text, parents wanted Jesus to touch their children. We don't know exactly why. Some of those children may have been crippled. Some may have been hurting. Some may have been blind. Some may have been healthy, but endangered in some way. Some may have been at risk from hunger. We don't know why their parents brought them. We simply know they did. And it's pretty easy to imagine what those parents said. "There he is. Go. Run to him." But there was a problem. A big problem. Christ was not the only one who had hands. Instead, he was surrounded by at least a dozen men who used their hands and arms and words to keep those kids away. Again, we don't know why, because the Bible doesn't tell us that, but it's not too difficult to imagine. Our leader's busy. He's got important things to do. He doesn't have time to mess with kids like you. Our text says that these disciples rebuked all of those children. And that's a pretty strong word in the New Testament. Jesus rebukes demons in chapter 1 of Mark's gospel. And Jesus rebukes Peter in chapter 8 of Mark's gospel, when Peter advises him to stop talking about his death. In the Old Testament, it's typically God who does the rebuking, not humans. Nonetheless, it's very tempting for us as humans to try to imitate God in that way. You're wrong. You don't belong in this setting. Get back in place. Some of you might remember that Martha rebuked Mary in that way. Stop acting like a male disciple, sister. Get back into the kitchen and help me serve the men. Jesus didn't like that. And he did not like the action of his male disciples in this morning's passage either. Mark says he was incensed. Agonakteo in Greek. Such a fascinating word. When describing a wound, it means inflamed or infected. When describing a person, it means irritated or provoked. It often had to do with people who seemed out of place. That's why the Pharisees were incensed by the crowds on Palm Sunday. Why are they running after him? And Christ's disciples were incensed when one poor woman broke a jar of costly ointment and poured it on Christ's head. That ointment could have been sold and given to the poor. She's way out of line here. But that story brings us back to this morning's Bible story, to a really important question. Who's really out of place? The disciples thought it was the children. Jesus thought, no, it's you. You disciples are not fulfilling your purpose. You're not fulfilling your call. You're just getting into the way. The disciples thought they were protecting him from those who might distract him from his mission. Instead, they became the source of distraction. That's why he got incensed. They thought they were stopping children from interfering with Christ's ministry. Instead, they were stopping Jesus from doing what he loved to do, touch. Jesus touched all kinds of people, rich and poor, young and old, sick and well, both physically and emotionally. He wanted us to be touched. When the disciples finally got that, they finally understood, these children were set free. First, I imagine they ran to Jesus and wrapped their arms around him. Then, much more important, our Savior wrapped his arms around the children. I love that. I love the intimacy of that. I picture lots of hugs and smiles. Then our text declares that he placed his hands on them and blessed them. That must have been such a remarkable experience, to be touched and blessed by God. We don't know exactly what Jesus said to those children, but we do know what he said to his disciples. Whoever does not enter the kingdom of God like a little child shall never enter it. That had to get their attention. Having blocked those kids from Jesus, it had to get their attention. I hope it still gets ours. Because if it does, it forces us to ask, what does it mean for folks like us to enter the kingdom of heaven as a little child. Well, I can tell you what it does not mean. It does not mean that you must earn your spot in heaven through many years of righteous living and good deeds. Children do not yet have that. Nor does it mean that you can win a spot in heaven through your resume. Look at all the goods I sold, all the folks I managed, all the good that I have done for my company. And children don't have that either. It certainly does not mean that you can buy your way to heaven through all the wealth and power you have attained. Nor does it mean that you can claim a spot in heaven through your allegiance to God's party, whatever that may be, conservative or liberal, traditional or contemporary, Republican or Democrat. Because young children don't have all that. If this morning's text is true, you cannot win a scholarship to heaven through your mastery of doctrine or Bible trivia. What can you do? You can enter the kingdom of heaven through the simple childlike desire to run to Jesus' arms, asking him to touch you, asking him to hug you, asking him to bless you in that way. Like a little child, perhaps you'll come to Jesus with your boo-boos and show him to the Lord. This spot really hurts. Or perhaps you'll bring your baubles, little crafts that you have made. I did this one for you. Or perhaps you'll bring your bugs. Look at that one, Jesus. Isn't that one really cool? If this morning's text is true, it doesn't really matter what you bring into our Savior's arms. The only thing that matters is that you go there. You go running, exposing your vulnerability and your heart. So if this morning's text is true, if St. Mark really got it right, then I think this text invites us to ask three crucial questions. First, how would your life be different if you looked at those you'd like to block from the fellowship of faith as Christ looked at the children in this morning's text? That one is too selfish. That one is too sinful. That one is a bully. That one is a wimp. That one is divisive. That one is unworthy in some way. That's what we think. But how would life be different if you looked at all those folks as you look at children, little children, each one of whom is craving our attention in some way? Hug me, love me, praise me, teach me, help me to be special in some way. Most children don't know how to get the things they need in the right way until some kind-hearted person shows them. When that does not happen, their bodies grow, but their hearts wither. They might be 48 or 68 for that matter, but inside they are still children. They still feel like hurting kids. How would your life be different if you looked at the folks you tend to repel like that? That's question number one. Here's number two. How might your life be different if you honestly believed that Jesus wanted to receive you like the children in this morning's text? Let the children come to me and do not hinder them. He knows when you've been childish. He knows when you've been selfish. He knows when you've been mean. You really don't have to hide it. Nor do you have to blame it on someone else. Mikey made me do it. Nonsense. Christ knows it's nonsense. You simply have to come to Him. Most of us who have been parents get this at some level. We know intuitively what Christ means. Of course, we all feel proud when our children are successful. They ace the test. They won the game. They developed some great new skill. That makes our hearts glad. But we love them even more, I think, when they failed. They failed the test. They lost the game. They tried to sing or sketch and bombed. Your heart just goes out to them. It really does. How would your life be different if you honestly believed that Jesus looks at you that way? That's question number two. Here's number three. How would your prayer life change if you came to Christ in this manner every single day? You begin your prayer by thinking, Jesus wants to see me. Jesus wants to hug me. Jesus wants to hear exactly what has happened in my life today. What difference would that make? When Andrew, our child, first got into school, he struggled in some ways. He just could not sit still. So on many days, when we picked him up from school, he'd sort of stomp into the car and say, "Got time out again." He was so angry, both with himself and with others. But he was also honest. Since he knew we would embrace him no matter what had occurred, he didn't hide a thing. He didn't have to. And that was sweet. It really was. Some days, of course, were different. Some days he'd say, "I made a new friend this morning," or "I learned some really cool things." We had fun with him on those days. But my favorite days, my favorite ones of all, were the days he came to us with some little craft he made. Might be a paper Valentine or a homemade card. "I did this for you, Daddy. This one is just for you." One year, he made me a paper necktie, and drew all sorts of squiggly lines across it. He also used different colors, 10 or 12 at least. Then he handed it to me on Father's Day. I loved it. I really did. I kept that tie on my office door for years. In fact, it would still be there today if it didn't embarrass him as a teen. I didn't treasure it because I saw it as a world-class work of art. I treasured it because it was a symbol of his heart and of his love for me. How would your prayer life be different if you went to God like that? Not sinless, no one is, but guileless, open, honest, pure. According to St. Mark's gospel, and according to the words of Jesus Christ, God's kingdom was created for those who come to him like that. With those thoughts in mind, let us pray. Dear God, thank you for the beauty of this morning's text and for the message that it proclaims. Thank you that we're invited to come into your presence like little children. No pretense, no resume, no arrogance, and no shame. Thank you for the promise that you will receive us no matter what we said and did. And thank you for the opportunity that we have to share that love with others. In your mercy and your grace, help us do it well. For we do ask it in our Savior's holy name. Amen. Please join me now in our closing hymn. Good news of the gospel. In the imagination of our God, you were created. Your hands, your face, your eyes bring our God joy. Through the blood of Jesus Christ, you've been redeemed from sin and sloth and shame. Leave all of that behind. Through the power of the Holy Spirit, you've been revived to live and love and laugh and sing again. So go forth with God's blessing to bless the lives of others, remembering that Christ longs to meet with you. Amen.
Lord.